Hi, everybody. How are you doing? Good, good, good. So we are going to get into a conversation about fighting poverty with technology. And we've had an incredible day from starting off from diaries and stories and snapshots, some poetry. But I think for me, one of the highlights is President Sorrell's kind of comment, keeping the promise. And I think that's sort of a shared North Star we have here in this conversation. While technology is a tool that can be both a great accelerator of opportunity and unlocking potential, it can also have the risk of being a tool that can further disparity and leave some behind. And so a couple just quick thoughts before I turn the car keys over to some fantastic leaders out there in the field. I just want to remind us when we think about sort of the generational nature of inequality and opportunity. And as some of you must know, Raj Chetty's research looking in 1940, where 92% of children were able to earn more than their parents. And if you fast forward to 1980, that 92% rate shrunk to 50%. And then if we hop over and just think a little bit about the inequality nature, just in 2014, 1% of the US population held 35% of accumulated wealth. 35%. 0.1% had 15%. So when we think about technology being that unifier, that accelerator, I'm really excited to hear some of the ideas from Jim Shelton and Elisabeth Mason. Two quick things about Jim. As many of you know, he's now as president of education with the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative. He also is deputy secretary for education at the Department of Ed, overseeing incredible policy management programming. Also, the Innovation I3 grant, really sort of the steward of innovation, has had incredible career in both the private, public, and nonprofit sector, and is a resident of the District of Columbia. We claim you. And father of two fabulous boys. Elisabeth Mason, who is going to be setting the world on fire at the new Stanford Lab for Poverty, Opportunity, and Technology. Not only has she had an incredible career in philanthropy from Robin Hood and other places, but also was really the founder and the visionary behind Single Stop, that just unlocked opportunity and integrated services that put people and students at the center of higher ed. And I've actually had the privilege of meeting many of the students down in Miami and across the country that have personally benefited from the work that you've done, and sing your praises. So from the big sort of perches you have to just the people that you touch every day, I thank you both for your leadership. With that said, Elisabeth, you've now landed at Stanford. You opened up this lab in November. Talk to me about how you're seeing the big picture in terms of poverty and the role of technology and what you are thinking about accomplishing at Stanford.
Thanks. Well, I think we're facing just a huge opportunity. I mean, one of the biggest shifts in human society probably in the last several hundred years, if not in the last several thousand. And there are big questions about how that's going to affect everybody, all of us, but specifically those of us at the lower income levels. How are we going to share in some of that abundance, and how are we going to be affected by those shifts? When I arrived at Stanford actually to work at the Center on Poverty and Inequality, where we're housed, the first question I asked was, what's going on campus around poverty and opportunity technology? How are we using these new tools, which are really a revolution in human society, and they're gonna reorganize everything we do, from education to work to housing to health. How are we looking at those tools and making sure that we're actually designing, developing, and rolling out those tools for those of us in the most need? And it was really interesting looking around Stanford. There are a number of really interesting efforts, as there are around the country, but what we found was that there wasn't a center to really focus on this, not just in terms of developing or moving out technologies that could be applied to the biggest social problems, but also to help develop a field where we're really making those investments. The reality is, as you said in your opening, you know, technology is just a tool, that's all it is. And whether it becomes sort of a dystopian future or a utopian future, I think is largely up to us. How do we drive it? How do we develop it? And so we're excited to be working at Stanford, both across faculty, but also with partners in the not-for-profit and government sectors, and with people in communities, most importantly, to design and develop new technologies that can be helpful and actually influence this for the good versus the ill.
Great, that's so powerful. So Jim, we'd love to hear, you at Chan Zuckerberg, you are very focused on personalized learning, making sure all kids reach their full potential. How are you seeing technology in the work that you're doing now, and also just the big picture?
So I do want to start with the big picture before we get to the technology part, because I think that we're seeing every day that where you start with what you believe about what your intent is and what's possible changes how you think about anything that you're doing, and in particular what the lead outcome ought to be. And so Mark and Priscilla started out with a pretty bold statement that they wanted to advance human potential and promote equality. And they started with education because they believed that pathway is there. But they also started with a belief set that said that, that there's talent equally distributed throughout the world, and that people are able to perform at levels that are currently, well, frankly, what many people might not believe relative to where we perform today as human beings. If you start with that fundamental premise, that that is where people have the potential to go, and that in, when you figure out how to unlock that potential in people, that the people of the world will actually solve the problems that we think are insurmountable today, then you start to do things very differently. So that is the big mission. The part of the mission that I'm focused on is how do you actually dramatically change those learning outcomes, and what is possible to do that, and how do you do that and do it in a way that solves the other part of the challenge that we seem to struggle with in the, not only in the education sector, but I would say in the social sector, which is how do you take those things that really, really work to scale? Technology has been a big part of the answer to that question in almost every other sector. I'm really excited to be on the stage with Elisabeth because she's one of my heroes. When I found Single Stop, I thought, this is really, really smart. And then she was developing a technology platform to do the work, making it fast and much cheaper than it ever been done before. And then at some point we were having a conversation and I was like, this is brilliant, but it shouldn't exist, right?
Yep.
The reason that it existed, if you think about it, and for those of you not familiar, it actually made it very simple for someone to figure out their eligibility for benefits and then to begin that enrollment process, like, within minutes as opposed to hours and many, many trips and much frustration later. Why would a nonprofit organization need to create something like that? Because we in government had failed to figure out how to create that kind of customer experience ourselves. So the opportunity is for us to not only think about how can technology transform things that we can do from the outside in, but how can technology change the way our fundamental systems work so we can do much more in seemingly in an environment where less is the operative word with less, or with the same amount and serve many, many more people in much better ways. So let's bring that then into learning. In the 70s, there was a guy by the name of Benjamin Bloom who asked a really simple question. It was, if you gave every child highly favorable conditions, what could they actually do? Like, seems like a reasonable question somebody should ask a long time before the 70s. And his proxy for that, though, was, if I can give every single child an expert tutor that meets them every day, that works with them, figures out what they know, what they don't know, what they think they know that they don't really know, and take them as far as they can go, what could they do? And it turned out that the answer to that was that at the end of a period, the average student that got a one-on-one tutor would outperform in the control group or regular classroom kids 98%. Now, for those of you who don't remember, that turned out to be two standard deviations. And then it became known famously as the two standard deviation problem. Because, okay, now I know this, right? I know that if I repeat this experiment again and again, I can get average kids to outperform 98% of other kids. That's an incredible thing. I can get the kids who are in the bottom decile into the high 80th percentile of the normal classroom. But where am I going to get all those people, and when am I going to get all that money? Now, you can answer that question in a lot of ways, but what is exciting to me is now I have a problem to solve. The problem to solve is, if you don't believe that kids can do it after I tell you that story, and you see the evidence that he was able to repeat this experiment again and again, if you don't believe kids, and the vast majority of kids can perform at that level, you have some other thing going on. We'll leave that to the side. So then you say, the question, only question at that point is, can I create those kinds of conditions, that kind of learning experience, in any other way, in a way that we are willing to pay for? And in that context, it is almost impossible to think that you can do it unless technology is an important part of it. And the last thing I'll say on this is, you can't think that you're going to empower learners that way unless you empower the teachers, both the formal and informal ones, that support and guide them every day. So this is not just about learner empowerment, this is about teacher empowerment, and it's about turning many, many other people into teachers that have the tools and resources to dramatically improve outcomes. And I'll stop there.
That's great.
And just to add on that, if I can, I mean, one of the things that I like the most about the way CZI has sort of set up its framework around learning is the acknowledgement that learning also is not something that happens in a vacuum. And one of the biggest difficulties we've had in our service sector, right, and actually one of the things that drives the most inefficiencies is this sense of silos, where, you know, we're delivering services, whether it's the two generations piece that Aspen is focused on under you, and we're delivering services to the parents versus, and not looking at the kids, the kids versus the parents, or whether we're looking at healthcare and not thinking about its impact on education or other social services. So one of the things I like the most about that is, you know, not only can you scale, can you look at personalized learning, but can you look at the environment in the family and the community around that supports that so that it makes it possible for kids to access the best in learning that's available.
And I go one step further, and I promise we'll let ask you a question.
Good.
But the interesting thing is, you can't say you're going to personalize learning without starting with the status of the learner. Right? Physically, socially, emotionally, mentally, those things all interact with each learner experience. So if you say you're going to personalize learning, you by definition are saying you are going to take a holistic approach. And one of the things that was really attractive to me, frankly, about this opportunity was that that was a complexity that Mark and Priscilla really appreciated. Priscilla being a person who has spent her after being a teacher, went to become a doctor, a pediatrician in particular, and has worked in safety net hospitals through her whole career. So that notion is intuitive to them. Didn't need to explain it to them in any particular way.
Well, one of the things that we were talking about earlier also is you putting technology next to culture change and to values and what we really value. I mean, when you're talking about the teacher or the frontline social worker or connector, and also the science, and specifically the science around the brain science. And I was sort of kind of going to open it up broadly and then let you guys run with it. But I don't know if Alan Van Capella is still here from Education Alliance, which is an anchor institution in New York City serving literally millions of families across the generations, been around for 127 years. And we were just talking last night, pre the summit, and he said, my caseworkers and social workers spend 64% of their time on paperwork. Just imagine if that time could be focused on the human and the human connection, and I could also be walking into a home with an iPad and sort of saying, oh, grandma needs this, mom needs this, child needs this, and it could immediately go off to the different departments. Like just small sort of transformations like that. But also he talked about how they train their staff through holistic support so that they're the most important and able to reach families. And so I set that up a little bit, Elisabeth, because you have done incredible service from really frontline work with youth to doing systems change like Single Stop and Robin Hood and so forth. You know, what does that culture change look like? And then run with it next, Jim, or whichever way you guys want to go. You've done a lot of work in terms of thinking about the science of learning and development and how sort of what we're learning around brain science and just human development more broadly. Would love for you guys just to run with that a little bit. So start off with you, Elisabeth, if you would.
Yeah. So Education Alliance, I don't know if he is here, but Education Alliance is one of my favorite nonprofits, and partially because they do great work, but partially because they're from East Harlem, which is where I grew up. And you know, just thinking about intentionality and work and why you do it and what the values are. you know, you see whole generations of folks be beaten down or frankly lost based on the some purposeful policies, but also some really ineffective policies. So I think that we're now facing a moment where we can really rethink, given the technology and data revolutions that we're in. I mean, I was just actually just came through the United Arab Emirates, where the front page of the newspaper yesterday morning was that they are now 3D printing skyscrapers, which of course they're doing for a bank, right? But imagine the impact that you could have on housing, for example. Imagine Silicon Valley, where you're having a huge housing problem and crisis, especially for low-income folks. And imagine if you can actually drop prices like that. There are folks who are now experimenting in 3D printing food. What does that mean, right? When you can all of a sudden possibly take care of many basic needs in that way. And then the middle of the paper, which is very interesting, was that they were using robots in classrooms. Now they're deploying them next year in Dubai. Right, so it just gives you a sense of where this is going versus where we are in the United States. What was interesting in Dubai was they actually specifically are deploying them as a teaching assistants, which they haven't had in the classrooms before, right? They're not replacing teachers. So how you actually use these new tools in a values-based format to make sure that you're encouraging the best of what human endeavor can be and freeing up people to do the more complicated tests and the tasks that we want human interaction with, but taking away the things like paperwork, or figuring out how to use data to do better integration, or how to actually better target your interventions and use your money more effectively. I think those things become the real opportunities, and there's a lot of low-hanging fruit out there that we can address.
Yeah, I mean, I think that if you said, like, what has been the big kind of takeaway from a bunch of science stuff, like the other initiative that was started at the Chan Zuckerberg initiative that came next with science, and you say, well, what is one of the biggest kind of insights of the last few decades, and it's genetic diversity. That, frankly, the amount of diversity among us is significant. It means that the approach to solving whether cancer or many other problems comes down to our ability to adapt to that level of diversity. And how we actually harness tools and resources that let us do that, where we can better target and tailor what the interventions and supports need to be, is going to be the way we'll not only unlock value, but also do it in a way that is more efficient than we've ever been able to do it before. Like, I mean, in the education context, and building off of what Elisabeth was talking about, like, the big thing about being able to 3D print is zero waste, right? Like, you don't print extra and then cut it out, you just print it right the first time. In the educational context, the big question is, we have never figured out what a system would cost that got it right with every child the first time, every time. What if we weren't repeating and holding back in summer school? What if we weren't inaccurately putting kids into special ed or putting them in for the wrong reasons? What if we actually knew which interventions work best on which kinds of delays? What if we understood those things and then were much better at deploying them as early as possible in the most precise way, and in a way that could be sustained over time as necessary, but was designed to get you back on track? No one can say that's how our system works today, right? But you can imagine a system that works that way. And the good news is, like, we don't have to, like, imagine parts of this. There are parts of it that we know. We know that if you do early screening and diagnostic on many of the delays that kids have, take speech, one of the most common, that the ability to get kids back on track once they get the interventions is extraordinarily high. Yet, less than 5% of kids that are, particularly that are low income, will actually get diagnosed before they hit school. Doesn't have to be hard. Another one, this is really, really obvious. It drives me crazy right now. Everything does not need to be complicated. Recent study in Los Angeles, if you are low income, and in the first grade, and you need glasses, there's a 95% probability you do not have them. Might not be a driver of a lot of other things, but it can't be helping. right? So there are the really complex technological solutions, and then there are the ones that are not so complex. And there's the combinations where now there are tools that make it really easy for almost any school nurse to do the first level examination, almost zero marginal cost once you've got the equipment. And then all of a sudden you can very quickly start to decide who actually needs glasses and who needs additional services.
And maybe print them in the school. I'm just saying. Yeah. I mean, that's the level. I mean, I think that's the exciting thing about the what if. Yeah. We can actually ask questions now about what if we can actually eliminate many of the problems that we have in education that we've had historically. We can ask what if we can actually answer basic needs for everybody right within the next 10 or 20 years. So I think there is this huge, brave new world. The issue is how do we embrace it and how do we target these investments in a way that gets the results that we're looking for?
Well, one of the things that we were talking around the what if is also when you're asking the questions and who's sitting around the table talking about the solutions. And one of the things that I loved about the lab, just by way of example, was you set it up very deliberately. Business, technology, harnessing the student and faculty power of Stanford. And then you said the people we're ultimately serving are in the lab. I was overjoyed. A lot of times it seems so common sense. You want to have the focus of, in our case, we're working on children and families, part of the conversation, but so often that doesn't happen. And so how do we think about sort of who's at the table around these dialogues and from incredible positions you both have, how are you setting the table? How are you bringing voices into this conversation, both asking the questions, delivering the answers, being part of the solutions from a position of power, not just coming in as the client or whatever? Curious to hear your thoughts.
Go ahead.
I'll just say this very briefly. I think if you go to communities, low-income communities across this country, you go into communities of color, and you ask them whether the data that's being produced is accurate or whether the questions that are even being asked are the right questions, you will probably invariably hear that it's not the case. So I think that if we're going to think seriously about solving problems that exist for millions of low-income families at the community level, we have to think seriously about incorporating the communities into those answers. And I think there's some really, really incredible answers already coming out. And the reality is that most low-income communities or most families haven't risen, right? Don't move up the economic ladder necessarily because of the help of government or the help of other structures, although certainly those are important and they're very critical enablers. I'm not giving up on those, even in this moment federally. I don't think we can give up on those. But a lot of solutions in the innovation happens at the community level. I think we forget that. Yeah. I think we forget about how much knowledge there is at the community level. And there's such a sort of prism through which we vote, whether it's the fintech stuff and you say, oh, well, you know, people don't know how to spend their money. Well, actually they do, but you don't have any sense of how complex the smoothing out of their income is or when the income comes in or, you know, what other decisions they're making around. We look at all these things and I think the same thing with education all the time. Parents make decisions or students make, and often they're rational decisions within an irrational system. So how much we can actually bring in the voice of, you know, both diverse perspectives, right, and from different parts of community, because there's not one community across this country either, into the design process and into the data, so that data is actually reflective of the real problem and the needs. I think it's just absolutely critical to getting the right answers.
All right. The first part, though, is just listening well. Right?
Yes.
So, you know, take over a new job. What do? You figure out what you think your strategy is going to be. You talk to really, really, really smart people, and you do lots of research. But I spent a good portion of the last several months in community, in Atlanta, in high schools in Atlanta, talking to students and talking to teachers about what they think it actually needs to look like, how they respond to these ideas that I'm putting out, what is the problem that they really need to have solved before they can begin to think about things this way. Mm-hmm. And to Elizabeth's point about people making rational decisions in the context of an irrational system, like, you hear a lot about why people do what they do. And it becomes really apparent why things don't go to scale, right? And you go, I'll use this quick example. In the education technology space, people used to all the time complain, the culture of education is just so slow. I used to go, all right, let's just diagnose this for a second. Teacher has maybe 4 computers in the back of the room, one of which is guaranteed not to work. They've got some software that you promise is going to work really well, but maybe not. And they're supposed to stop and figure out how to get it all to work, figure out what all the other kids are supposed to do, rotate everybody through. Now tell me again why they're going to do that. Right? And yes, I would really like them to do it, but it is not an irrational decision that you might have a higher value way to impact the kids in front of you every day. So we have to think it all the way through.
Yeah.
How do you actually let them solve the problem they're trying to solve? Mm-hmm. How do you let them have the impact on kids' lives that they got into the profession to do? And how do you make it easier to do it? Teachers work miracles. They shouldn't have to. I'll end there.
Yeah, well said. Well, as we get ready to wrap up, I think you know, we were talking about just, and Brian, no one says it better than Brian Stevenson, about getting proximity to those that you're serving and the problem you're trying to solve. And when I think about inequality and opportunity, and we certainly think about Silicon Valley, that certainly brings up a vivid image. And I'm delighted that Oscar Chavez is here from the Sonoma County Human Services Department, who's been working with 9 counties, including the Silicon Valley area, who are really committed to taking on inequality and opportunity. And you know, there might be some ways following on the conversation here today to keep this conversation moving.
Let's
and maybe
it.
Even
That'd be great.
Bring it home and take it to the primary school and to the lab.
That'd be great.
And so I just wanted to give a shout out to him. But I think it's amazing to feel the power of innovation that's in this room and commitment that's in this room that have come from as far as Hawaii to Texas and New York and all around. And so I'd love to have your last, just invite you to say your last thought as we think about in this kind of policy environment, what's a bright spot you see coming up from communities or states or anything you have to leave for Washington before you guys head back west? But I want to give you a chance to sort of just put out a bright spot or a word of wisdom.
Jim? I mean, I'm inspired by the fact that people recognize that the need for urgency and pace has never been greater. And so you're seeing this surge of energy and resources and intellect coming in to try and solve these problems using the best of what we think we know about how to do these things well. And like that has always worked. I believe it's going to work again.
Thank you, Jim. Elisabeth, last word.
I agree with that. I mean, I think that you're seeing responses across the country, whether it's political, as well as in sort of the nonprofit space, that's pretty incredible. So I think there's a rapid surge of response. But I also think that, you know, when you talk about Santa Clara County, for example, some of the best work that's going around the country is going on in Santa Clara County, both at the, you know, workforce reform area or whether it's in early childhood. There's some really incredible things. So I do think that in a moment of, let's just talk about the real difficulty, beyond the sort of movement building piece, which I think is really necessary, but the real difficulty of what people are going to be facing in communities across this country in the next couple of years, it's not gonna be all rosy, it's gonna be challenging. And I think there is an opportunity in some of that, in, you know, I don't think you can make lemonade out of this entirely, but in as much as you can, there is an opportunity, I think, at the local level when funds come down through devolution, which they will, to really start rethinking these systems. Because the reality of these systems is they're very, very important, critical to people's lives, but they're also semi-broken. So in as much as we have an opportunity, I think, at the local level to really focus on innovation at the states, in the counties, there's going to be some pretty amazing opportunities to integrate across these silos and to introduce new innovation in the next couple of years.
Awesome. Well, we can count on technology continuing to move forward as a tool for learning, work, play, community, and civic engagement. So thank you for the being sure that technology is for good for all. Jim Shelton and Elisabeth Mason, thank you both.
Thank you.